Hello, I'm Richard Oehler. I work here at the T.J. Watson Research Center. I'm going to describe for you today the evolution of power architecture from its earliest beginnings here at research as the 801 project through power architecture, which has embodiments in the RS6000, to the newest developments, PowerPC architecture. My colleague, Mike Blasgen, will describe for you the evolution of the power architecture to 64 bits. So let us begin. The 801 project started here in research as a small team of engineers, programmers, mostly operating system people and compilers. We studied machine organization and traces of instructions and derived from that several principles that became known as the characteristics of RISC processors. They included very simple instructions that we could execute in one cycle. They also included the notion that instructions are separated from data. They are split into two separate storage areas or caches, and that the caches are programmed managed. From these earliest days at the in research of the 801, we actually built a processor running at 16 MIPS, 16 and a half MIPS about. It was called the 801. That was done during the years 1975 through 77. There have been many uses of that RISC processor here in IBM. It has been embedded in the I/O controller of big 370 machines. We also built one 370 engine, the 9370, with the internal core of the 801 processor. Since that time, we have spent a period of looking at the machine organizations that were built from these design principles. We've looked at instruction traces running on these machines, and we've come to certain conclusions. In the period of 85 and 86, we had a small project here at research called the America Project. This project in many ways defined the notion of superscalar. That is, the ability in machine organization to, in parallel, execute multiple instructions of different types. These ideas have grown into a very large number of processes, both within IBM and in the industry. The thing that we found missing in the RISC processes was an emphasis on high-performance floating point. We thought we had a natural match of the very simple notion of loads and stores and the heavy operations of floating point. The superscalar approach would allow us to operate on floating point in parallel with loads and stores from memory. We also discovered, we thought, that there was a need to fix certain problems in the RISC architecture, namely having to do with linkage conventions and having to do with string operations. And I'll describe these in more detail in a moment. The power architecture, that's the architecture of the RS6000, separates the processor into units. The units are the branch unit, the fixed unit, and the floating point unit. These units contain the registers associated with the data flow. So the fixed point unit has the fixed point registers, the floating point unit has the floating point registers, and the branch unit has the branch registers. There is not an automatic means of moving data from one register to in one unit to the registers in another unit. Consider a computation that would lead to a branch to a subroutine. If that computation is a fixed point operation, there is explicit program requirements to move the fixed point register from the fixed point register unit, fixing the fixed point unit, to the branch unit. In the development of the America architecture, we were fortunate to have a very sophisticated algorithm that allowed us to do multiply and add in a single cycle. Now, it actually takes more cycles in the machine, but the algorithm is such that it can be piped, and every cycle we can dispatch a floating point multiply and add, a full 64-bit multiply add, I might add. That operation, coupled with a fixed point separation, like I described a moment ago with superscalar organization, allowed us to execute floating point loads and stores overlapped with the multiply add operations of the floating point unit. This led to rather remarkable performance of many of the scientific problems associated with matrix operations and digital filtering. The compound instruction areas were a particular concern to us, as I mentioned before, because the linkage conventions in a RISC processor have always been a source of concern. We put in a load and store multiple instruction that would load many of the registers. We keyed it with the compiler so that only the registers that required to be saved were saved, and we think we have a very efficient linkage convention in the current power architecture. The string area was, as I mentioned before, again a concern for us. The string situation can best be thought about as how many cycles does it take to move a particular string, or saying another way, the number of bytes that actually get moved per cycle of the machine. As the path between the registers and the cache goes up, you would like to have in the architecture some way of managing that without requiring recompilation. The string ops give us some of that capability. In the storage area, we kept with the original 801 design of split caches and program management of that. We, in fact, went further and said that the I.O. System is not kept coherent with storage subsystem, which means that the program has to do explicit cache management of I.O. From the power architecture, the Advanced Workstation Division built now three distinct designs, resulting in many various products distinguished by their cycle time. The first design was called the Rios 1. It was a superscalar implementation. It had up to four instructions dispatched at a time. It was able to do logical operations, a fixed operation, float, and a branch operation, all within one cycle. Now, it always depends on whether or not the program has that many things to do, interspersed in some order, but in general, the processor was able to achieve performance beyond where any normal organization would be before we introduced the 6000. It had significant floating point performance, and it was a very large implementation. It was a multi-chip implementation that had each of the units I described as separate, fairly large chips. Next, we built the RSC, the Rios single chip. It integrated not only all the functions of superscalar that I described before, and branch and fixed and float, but also brought onto the chip the notions of storage control and some limited I.O. control for both interrupts and the microchannel. The technology was not advanced enough. The design of implementation of that chip doesn't have the characteristics of being a very superscalar implementation. The most recent addition to the power family is the Rios 2. It is very similar in organization to Rios 1, but it's much more aggressive in its superscalarness. It has the ability to execute in parallel two fixed point operations. They could be regular operations or they could be loads and stores. In addition, it has two floating point units. So now it's possible to perform even more rapidly in matrix operations because we can keep the balance between the fixed and float side, and problems that are considered like the Blas 2 and 3 set of problems allow us to have performance in a RIOS 2 that approaches vector machines. Having built three implementations of the power architecture, we learned quite a lot. The architecture is a big, or as I like to say, a rich architecture. We had a lot of commercial experience and compiler experience that went into the architecture. We had emphasis on the string operations, as I said, and we have put in again these compound instructions very much against the flow of the RISC architectures in the current environment. We tended to be over-specific in our definition. That is, we tend to pin down all of the cases where we really didn't have to. It would be an implementation choice to decide what a particular result will be, and I'll give some examples of that later. The architecture did not support symmetric multiprocessing, and it certainly didn't support 64 bits. So in summary, thinking about power architecture and its implementations, I would characterize it as very successful at the high end. It was very difficult to build in a small implementation in small silicon area. And then we had several concerns about how far we could push its superscalarness. These aggressive implementation techniques have to do with register renaming, which none of the RIOS 1 or RSC have on the fixed point side, and has to do with various interlocks. In addition, as we push the complexity of superscalar, we were finding that it was having an impact on the overall cycle time. In May of last year, we got together with Apple and Motorola, and we together, the three companies, embarked on an effort to try to simplify the power architecture. It came to be known as the PowerPC architecture. The basic ideas were that we would concentrate on making two different things happen. A smaller implementation. Apple was concerned about the price of large chips, especially in their smaller boxes. We were concerned about the same issue. Certainly Motorola was. We were also worried about how far we could push in terms of faster cycle time. So all these things together went into the evolution of power to power PC architecture. We had to do one other thing, we thought, which was certain things were inhibiting our use of very aggressive superscalar techniques. And we took pains in the architecture, even though it was going to cause us some amount of difficulty with existing programs, to loosen up certain areas of the architecture, and I will describe these later. We also discovered that we needed to add certain things that were missing from the architecture, floating point and the single precision variety, and we had to add storage coherency for two reasons. One, it was very difficult to program the I/O model that we had. And two, we were moving into multiprocessing, and that required that we have a storage coherency model. As I said, we had to do all these things while maintaining our binary compatibility at the power architecture. So we embarked on this process in July of last year. We have now finished the PowerPC architecture. We have grown it to include symmetric multiprocessing kept to our principles that we established early about weekly audit storage models and a reservation locking system, which again will be talked about later. And finally, we grew the PowerPC architecture to 64 bits.
Hi, I'm Mike Blasgen, and I want to talk about how we took the power architecture, which was a 32-bit architecture, into the 64-bit version of the PowerPC architecture. Now, PowerPC, we agonized a bit about this 64-bit versus 32. There's some allegations about true architectures versus not true architectures. And we wanted to do this right, but we also wanted to maintain compatibility with the 32-bit world that predominates today. So I think we did a fairly good job. We defined the PowerPC architecture as a true 64-bit architecture. It envisions, however, two implementations, a 64-bit implementation that encompasses the entire architecture, and a 32-bit implementation, which is a subset of the architecture. It's just missing a couple of instructions. It emits 64-bit arithmetic, and it emits 64-bit addressing. The 32-bit implementation is essentially a completely normal 32-bit implementation. The 64-bit is a complete 64-bit machine. Now, a 64-bit implementation can operate in two modes, a 64-bit mode in which everything is available, and a 32-bit mode for downward compatibility, so that if you have a 64-bit implementation, you can still run 32-bit programs. We think that this addition of accommodation for compatibility for 32 bits is essential for competitiveness, given that we see a world of 32-bit implementations and 64-bit implementations to be the case in the marketplace for many years. Now, once you have a 64-bit implementation, all the instructions and all the calculations are available in both modes, both the 32-bit mode and the 64-bit mode. For example, 32-bit modes can do 64-bit arithmetic. And 64-bit programs, if you want, can do 32-bit arithmetic for compatibility with integer programs. And where necessary to gain, for example, loading of a 64-bit quantity into a register, we've added new instructions, specifically the load store and 64-bit shifts. Otherwise, all the instructions are the same in the two modes. As a result, this mode bit, which is somewhat controversial, I'm sure you all remember that in the soul of a new machine, there was this banner headline, "No mode bit." We tried to minimize the effect of this mode bit, and as a result, it really only affects, first of all, and primarily, the interpretation of whether it's a 32-bit address or a 64-bit address, and a few other things about, for example, arithmetic, overflow, carry, and characterization of size. Now, I'm going to describe a little bit more about 64-bit addressing. Before I do that, it's best if I describe how 32-bit addressing works to take you through the PowerPC 32-bit addressing, which is extremely similar to the addressing that's in the RS6000 today. While mentioning the RS6000, it's interesting to go back and review the history of the names of these research projects. The original research project here at IBM was the 801 project. That project, I think we were rather uninspired, and we were somewhat at a loss as to what to name it. So we decided to name it the 801 project because the name of the building was the 801 building. This was in a history that had to do with the fact that IBM's 701 machine had been designed in the 701 building. When it came, however, to the America project, I think we were much more inspired. John Koch named that. John told the story, I think it's a well-known story, about Queen Victoria watching the yacht race completing in the Solent in England in the 1860s. And she asked her her aide what yacht was first. The first yacht had come into sight. And the aide said, the yacht America. And she said, and who is in second place? And the aide said, ma'am, there is no second place. We definitely wanted the RS-6000 to be the fastest there was, and still even today, in 1992, this machine on floating point benchmarks, for example, the spec 89 benchmarks or many of the spec 92 benchmarks, it is the fastest machine that you can buy. So to understand how we got that, so that's a story about power architecture, the RS-6000. That was a 32-bit machine, and PowerPC supports the same 32-bit machine. Now, the way it does that is by introducing three levels of address and two translations rather than the usual two levels of address with a single translation. So we distinguish between an effective address, which is the address computed by a CPU instructions, that is the address that's effectively computed by that instruction in load and store. The computation is normally the addition of a base register and an index register, or a base register and a displacement field in the instruction. That addition takes place as part of load and store, and then the load is done off that address. That quantity we'll call the effective address. We will distinguish that from the virtual address, which is translated by segment registers from the effective address into the virtual address. The virtual address is computed, as we'll see in a minute, by taking bits out of the effective address and using them to name a segment register, and thereby creating a name in a much larger, in the case of the 32-bit PowerPC, it's a 2 to the 52 byte address space, that is a 52-bit space. And then now that virtual address is then in turn translated into a real address by using page tables as you would expect to see in other machines. So we see this two levels of translation. Now you might ask, why did we introduce the extra level of translation? And basically it has to do with a vision of how we imagine these very large address spaces to work. In some ways we wanted, while we had a 32-bit limitation in the original architecture, we wanted to be able to get around some of the limitations the 32-bit, that 4 billion bytes introduces. Basically, in 4 billion bytes, there isn't enough room to map large objects, or at least very many large objects. So we introduced this intermediate virtual space where all the mappings can be held. So the idea is that, for example, in the AIX file system in the RS-6000, when you open a Unix file, under all circumstances, that file is first mapped into a virtual address space. And then in turn, that's done by just deciding where you're going to put it in virtual address space. Now that is in turn mapped and setting up the page tables. To map it into a process's effective address space, you simply set up segment registers, as I'll explain in a minute, to allow that process to identify, to be able to name bytes in that file. If another process opens the same file, and we certainly are very oriented towards sharing, we think that sharing among processes is key to the success of an architecture, enabling that sharing is key to the success of an architecture. If process 2 opens the same file, it can map the same file. It doesn't have to be remapped into virtual address space. It's already there. We can then map it into the second process to a possibly different location in its effective address space. So the mapping today looks like this. We have a 32-bit address translation which takes the 32-bit effective addresses, uses the four high-order bits as the name of a segment register, selects one of 16 segment registers, produces the virtual SID of 24 bits. Now, at this point, I might as well introduce the concept of a segment here. Segments are 256 megabyte objects, which are the combination of this page and byte offset. So they're 2 to the 28 bytes in length. And each segment has a name. By convention in the operating system in AIX, and this is the way we envision using it, a single object is mapped into one or more virtual SIDs. It's a one-to-many, or normally one-to-one mapping if the object is less than 256 megabytes. So that's done by mapping the segment, by taking the high-order bits of the segment register through the segment registers into the virtual address, and then through page tables into the real address. Now, let's see if we can characterize the properties that the scheme has. First of all, notice there is full protection here among objects. In other words, if a process tries to name an object in its address space that it's not authorized to do, it can't do it, since the segment register contexts require privilege state or supervisor state. So no process can name an object it hasn't opened, because it's through opening that the segment registers are set up. So this scheme does provide a large virtual address space, 2 to the 50, even though it's a 32-bit machine, it does provide a large 52-bit virtual address space to hold all the objects that you might want to hold. It does, at the same time, of course, permit just ordinary, each process has its own address space. That is, you don't have to invoke this sharing stuff if you don't want to. You can just use a conventional multiple virtual storage type scheme. Now notice here that the page tables, as a result of having the virtual address space, the page tables themselves are not process local. They are global. You never change the page tables in a machine. Segment register contents, of course, are process local and have to be modified whenever you switch processes. But though they are a relatively small amount of state compared to the page tables. Now there are some drawbacks with the 32-bit scheme. First, of course, it's only 32 bits. I mean, the reason we're going to 64 is to be able to run large programs with large data objects. You can't put 10 pounds of stuff into a 5-pound bag. So we're going to have to enlarge that. But we have other problems, which is that this 256 megabyte segment thing poses two difficulties. Number one, what happens if your object is larger than 256 megabytes? You have to deal with the trickiness of not only finding contiguous available space in the 2 to the 52 virtual address space, but you have to then line up the segment registers to be in sequence, contiguous, that is adjacent segment registers, to name large objects. That actually works. I mean, for example, in AIX on RS6000, you can open files that are larger than 256 megabytes, and we'll do that, but it's a bit of a pain. It certainly becomes a pain once you want to map more than 8 or 10 objects simultaneously, because you run out of the 16 segment registers. We've had various schemes for managing the segment registers, much as you manage general purpose registers, but they're not those schemes are not naturally matched to Unix, which I think is the lingua franca of the RISC machine today. So what we're trying to do with our 64-bit extensions is to preserve all these old advantages of being able to map objects into virtual memory, but fix these drawbacks that I've mentioned. So let's see how we do this. So let's remember the 32-bit scheme with its higher-order bits and its segment registers mapping into the virtual and then into the real. Now, as we expand smoothly to 64 bits, we see the 4-bit segment register field becomes the 36-bit effective segment identifier field, which is now translated using a segment table rather than segment registers. The translation now is from a 64-bit effective address to an 80-bit virtual address, and then in turn down to a 64-bit real address. The segment table itself is done by holding the effective segment identifier as well as the virtual segment identifier, and really doing a associative lookup on the effective address. So if the effective address is in the segment table, it translates to the virtual segment identifier. Each process has its own segment table now, and a process switch will change a control register to point at a new table in memory. Now, since this is an associative lookup, it can't be done in general at high speed, the speed required to do a single cycle load. So what we've done is we've architected, that is, we've defined in the architecture, visible to programs, something called a segment look-aside buffer. This is just a cache of the segment table, much like a TLB, translation look-aside, caches the page tables. Now, notice that in this 64-bit scheme, protection is just as before. As before, you can't name a segment that you have that's not in your address space. The only way it can get into your address space if it's in the segment table, and the segment table is not accessible in problem state. This basically, if you just generate any old number and try to translate it, it won't translate because there's no segment ID in the segment table. And we think this will encourage the direct mapping of objects into this very, very large address space. So let's look at how we did compared to the 32-bit scheme. As before, the page tables are not processed local. All the virtual to real addressing is done on a system-wide basis. And the TLBs in particular are not purged on process switch, nor are they tagged with the address space ID. However, SLBs do have to be purged, or alternatively tagged, on process switch. And now, as far as mapping very large objects, we can certainly find lots of space in this very large virtual address space. The virtual address space, after all, is 80 bits in length. The effective address space is 64 bits in length. Lots of space in there to map large objects, so we can use contiguous segments to allocate essentially arbitrarily large objects subject only to the 64-bit limit. And we can certainly map lots of objects simultaneously. For example, if objects are constrained to 256 megabytes in size, we can map up to 2 to the 36 of them. So we got lots of opportunity for mapping here. And we do pay some price here. There's the price of a little extra circuitry for doing essentially the associative lookup in the SLB. And of course, you do have to purge and reload the SLB with process switch. So in summary, I think we've extended to 64-bit addressing in such a way that we have full accommodation for 32-bit programs. We also, of course, envision both 32-bit implementations and 64-bit implementations. We, of course, provide the standard thing you want from 64-bit addressing, which is support for large programs and large data. We support standard multiple 64-bit address spaces for those systems like Unix that require it. And finally, I think we've created a system which will encourage, and it remains to the software community how much they'll exploit this, permit system-wide addresses for object mapping, and as a result, for sharing of those objects between multiple processes, and at the same time preserving fast process switch. So thank you, and now I'd like to give it back to Rich, who'll give us some details on the computational aspects of the instruction set.
Now I'm going to talk about what we did in the computational instruction set. First the deletions, then the changes, and finally the additions. So let's consider the problem that we faced. We had several registers, particularly the MQ register on the fixed point side, that was a single register, was the target of many of the extended shift instructions and the long form of multiply that developed a 64-bit result, and held one of the operands on the long form of the divide. Now, in superscalar implementations, a single register like the MQ becomes a severe bottleneck to allowing the processor to select instructions and execute them in parallel. So it was clear to us that we had to remove the MQ. At the same time, we were concerned about the effects on our existing programs. And we went and studied that, realized that there were a class of applications that performance-wise would suffer. And we needed a way of covering the fact that certain of the instructions that it depended on heavily were deleted. Therefore, we invented, it was something I'll talk about later, a trap and emulate facility. So we had to remove the MQ and the associated instructions. We had to take out the long form of multiply, and we had to remove this long form of divide. That solved some of our problems, but we had other difficulties as well. There were some of instructions that generated a result quite late in the data flow on the fixed point side. Think about DOE's difference or zero. What it does is it looks at the result of a subtraction and decides whether to put the difference or zero into a target register depending on the sign. That instruction in an organization that was pushing the cycle time would cause a real delay, a measurable delay that forced us to take out that instruction. Again, we went back to where the compiler use of that instruction was. We did have very limited use. we concluded that we could remove that, replace it with a sequence, and continue to deal with programs that did use it in this trap and emulate mechanism. A more interesting case, one that was an instruction that at one point we thought was a very good idea, caused incredible complexity in the organization of what would be a sequencer in the processor, which was the load string and compare byte instruction. The definition of this instruction would take a C string terminated by a null character and load it to a set of one or more GPRs. It sounded like a good idea, and in fact our compilers began to use it. But as we got further and further into understanding the nature of the instruction and the way efficient programs deal with strings, it became very clear that real programs didn't use this construct when efficiency was an issue. They in fact had to go and organize strings so that they kept a length separated from the data and did not use the trick of a null terminated string. In practice then, in looking at real code running on AIX, we discovered that there was really very, very little use of this instruction, even though we spent, as I said, a lot of time in both the compiler and in the runtime libraries trying to make use of it. So it was an easy choice for us, after we realized these facts, to remove it from the architecture. There were other things like subtle changes that were things that we had to do, like remove the some of the cases for mass generation. Now, we've always believed that it was important to have a significant number of instructions that were able to efficiently manipulate bits within registers. We have various rotate instructions that insert bits and mask values to control exactly what bits do get inserted. The difficulty we had, though, was that being good architects, we had generalized the facility and kept in particular cases of mass generation that were difficult to do. They were hard to implement in a very aggressive cycle time, and they were a little used, and so we removed these. The last deletion we considered was brought about by realization in very aggressive superscalar implementations that the number of register ports is a real issue. We had one instruction in particular that required three input sources. We needed to fetch the source, to fetch a shift amount, and to fetch the target so that we could insert into it. This in turn caused, just to execute this one instruction, mandatory three ports to read from the register file. Originally, we thought in the machines like the 801 organization that because of the update loads and store with update instructions, that a typical register port files would be three on input and two on output. Or say a different way, that you would be able to fetch three values simultaneously and write two values back all within one cycle. Well, it was clear that by multiplying in aggressive superscalar implementations, the number of fixed point instructions in flight in execution at any one time, that those kind of multipliers would cause a great deal of difficulty, more complexity than was really worth it. And so in those type of implementations, it was possible to split apart the update load from actually loading the data and updating the target register value. That in turn, in a superscale implementation, could be done in parallel on each of the sides of the fixed point implementation. But this one instruction caused us to go to the full limit of the number of ports on the register. So we took this instruction out. Now I'd like to consider some of the changes that we put into PowerPC architecture. I guess because of our heritage that is coming from 360, 370 architecture, we felt compelled in the original Power architecture to well define all the cases. Let me give you some examples of some of the difficulties that architects face. Consider a load multiple instruction. What's required of it, especially when it's interruptible, is that it go compute an effective address from which it's going to load a long set of registers. That seems fine, but now think about what happens if the registers that are used to do the computation of the address of storage is within the range of registers that are being loaded, and then consider what happens when the instruction is interrupted. Well, in Power architecture, we solve that problem by saying that the register, if it was in the range that was used for the address computation, would be blocked. It would not be changed. This was, in a lot of ways, good architecture, but probably bad implementation. We changed it in PowerPC to allow the implementers the choice or freedom in dealing with the issue. Some cases they could block it, some cases they could say the results were undefined. This changes the programming model, but it changes it in a way that doesn't affect the compiler, doesn't affect the runtime environment that we've created, and in fact is good programming. It would seem to me that you would not write a program that would load a set of registers clobbering the register that you were using to identify the storage area if in fact you knew that instruction was interruptible. Another area that we concentrated on was in very small implementations, the string ops and the load and store multiple caused an increase in the area required. If you consider a sequencer to perform these instructions, it becomes a difficult task then to separate out all the components of the instructions, the arbitrariness of the registers that are specified, and use that as a input into the sequencer. When in fact, the standard usage of these instructions is from a compiler or is written in assembly language in a runtime environment once and for all. And so if you recognize that fact in an architecture and say there are preferred forms for instructions, allow implementations to take advantage when space is at a premium, when they want to reduce the complexity in the sequencer, then you can end up with an architecture that does justice to the way compilers generate code, at the same time allows the freedom in the implementation so that it can specialize the cases where it recognizes what the compiler generated. The third area that is a change in the architecture is we had a model of how instructions were executed. We assumed things like update load was done in one cycle. Now obviously the data is not going to be returned in one cycle, but if you consider the operation of not only doing the address computation, but instructing the memory to perform an operation, a load operation, then that all would be done in one cycle. In implementations like an aggressive superscaler, where you had multiple pipes to run those in parallel, you could still do it in one cycle, although in two pipes, but in a very simple implementation, it might be that you want to do those in two cycles, one after the other. So we defined a notion that allowed us to relax how many cycles were associated with each of the various classes of instructions. So things like alignment interrupt, where we thought alignment in general would be handled within a page on all cases, has been softened in the architecture. Dealing with exception values in floating point area, except for the case of something approaching zero, almost all the others, the NANDs and the infinities and that, do not occur. In power, we assume that all those were handled in hardware as rapidly as possible, usually with nothing more than a single cycle hit. In PowerPC, we recognized that that was a lot of hardware, and we could remove that hardware and allow implementation to take its time, typically trapping to software to do that fix-up. The same thing is true in double precision arithmetic. We assume that since we had such a good implementation of double precision floating point, that we could require implementations to do it in one cycle. Well, in very small chips, again, we were faced with the issue that the implementation may only have a single width data flow, and doing double precision might require a double pass around the data flow. And so we changed the architecture. Now, associated with the changes I mentioned in load and store multiple, we had to add then a mechanism that dealt with the preferred forms or the special cases that the hardware generated. And so we put in an idea of a fast trap. This was something in the decoder that when it recognized the preferred form, went to something that would be thought of as millicode, perhaps, or maybe even a microcode in the machine, really software that would deal with the very special case of the stylized preferred form. We did that both for string ops and the load and store multiple. Now, there's another issue associated with string ops that I'd like to bring out. It has to do with what I said in the beginning of the lecture, which is that the path between the registers and the cache is something that will limit how many bytes you can move, how many registers can be loaded in a single cycle. And in power, we concentrated on that and developed these ops so that we would be able to keep our code base current even when we changed the implementation to go with wider implementations of this path. The difficulty with that, as I said before, if you consider a load or store multiple in an aggressive superscalar machine with register renaming, is that you have to lock all those registers. You actually have to start the operation loading all those registers and then unlock the registers in order to maintain the program integrity. The consequences of that in aggressive machines is that typically the engineers throw up their hands and say, the only thing we can do is to drain the pipe, serialize on those instructions, and execute the instruction, and then resume. They cannot even release the locks prior to the completion of the entire instruction. So it became a real issue with us as to what other possibilities were. Now, we don't have the complete answer, but there's another way of approaching load and store multiple, which is called gathering. It is possible at the back end of the instruction, after it's executed in the storage queues, to look at the results that are there, look at and compare the addresses, and if possible, and the addresses are consecutive, perform a single operation. And that would allow us to cover a wider path. These are things that we are experimenting with even today in our current implementations. Now, there were also some things that we were lacking, although in the beginning we didn't think so, lacking in power PC architecture. We had, for instance, a floating point algorithm in the implementation that was could do a double precision operation in a single cycle. Now, we thought that that would be used by software in doing single precision computations, and that the only thing the software had to do was to, after all the computations were done on a particular value, truncate that value or round that value to a single number. It turned out that we were wrong about that in one respect. There are programs, often called SDDEC programs, sometimes they're even benchmark programs, that demand single precision operations throughout. In our scheme, then, of inserting a round to single after every floating point computation led to unsatisfactory marks. The difficulty is easily solved. You just add single precision floating point arithmetic to the architecture, which we did. We dropped out the MQ, as I said before, and we dropped out the long form of the multiply and divide. But we still, on occasion, need to develop the high end of a 64-bit product. And so we have added back into the architecture an instruction that generates the upper portion of that product. Likewise, on the divide side, our divide dealt with a 64-bit quantity to be divided. Now we had, having removed that instruction, a need to stick in an instruction that would deal with a 32-bit or short divide. We had to add to the architecture the support for the instructions that we dropped out. That is a trap and emulate. Again, the distinction between trap and emulate and the fast trap mechanism is that the fast trap mechanism is a combination hardware and software recognizing the preferred forms, allows us to go faster in those cases where we recognize what the compiler has done, the compiler or programmer has followed the rules. Whereas the trap and emulate is the standard trap and emulate of many architectures in dealing with this problem of compatibility in a downward direction. We completed the architecture of the logicals. We needed one more instruction, a subtract from. It sounds very strange to do an address computation, but in terms of thinking of it as a logical without a setting of the condition register, that one instruction then would allow, if the compiler used it, more parallelism, less synchronization on returning condition register values. And then last, we recognized that there was a case where the C language with single byte integers would require or could use an instruction that did a load byte and extend the sign. So that instruction was added to PowerPC. Some of the other changes that we put in the architecture had to do with a bunch of system-oriented issues. In general, without really knowing what we had in power architecture, we had a weekly audit storage model. That means that in looking at how a program behaved, one got always the right answer when one stood on the processor side of the storage interface. However, if you were on the other side of the storage interface, you had no guarantee what the ordering would be of individual loads and stores. We allowed the processor to rearrange things going out to suit busy conditions on the bus, the availability data, and so on. We didn't well specify this in the power architecture. It became very clear to us that we needed architecture now as we became more aggressive in the use of superscalar techniques, that the reordering of storage was really going to happen a great deal. So if you think about it a minute, if you explicitly allow it in an implementation, it is possible to do a load that misses in the cache, hold that load off on the side, do another load that returns values from the cache. Worse yet, on the storage side, a store that is a store-through implementation on a cache would perhaps miss requiring a fetch from storage, but the processor goes on and finds another store and execute it. And finally, the cache is filled, and the data from the first store goes out. So now they're really out of sequence. So recognizing that as a characteristic of the memory subsystem or storage subsystem said that we had to be very explicit in the use of synchronization instructions or barriers. We added synchronization instructions for data. That is, it was a way of guaranteeing that all instructions before it completed and no instructions after it had started. We added instructions or semantics with existing instructions for broadcasting in caches. That is, even though we have a model now that has I/O consistency, I/O coherency with the cache, it is still the case that there are situations when you have to remove the data from the cache. We don't extend the coherency to the iCache. We still have the problem of when a program modifies itself or a simulator is generating instructions to be executed requires explicit cache manipulation. If you're going to be in an MP system, you have to guarantee that that's going to work on any processor in between any instructions. And so you need a broadcast mechanism on the cache to guarantee the integrity of that data. You have to deal with the problem of TLB shootdown, that is when the page tables are required to be changed by an operating system, the TLB reflecting a cache of those tables has to be updated. Well, it's easy to do it on the processor you're executing the change on. It's very difficult to do in the other processors. And so if you add to the architecture a feature that says the TLB invalidate parts of the architecture are broadcast, then it is possible to do it. Now, we didn't do this completely in a general fashion. We still allowed this to be an optional section of the architecture. That means that at the low end, the more traditional changing of the TLB and the using software to synchronize the other processes, generating a signal, taking an interrupt on the other processes, waiting for the other processes to come back. That implementation is still a viable implementation at the low end, but if you want performance and you want high speed, then you use in the implementation the TLB shootdown instructions. We also had to add one additional barrier for I/O. It became clear to us that the full synchronization in a large MP system was a time-consuming instruction. Synchronization of local processors, synchronization of all the storage operands associated with that local processor visible to the other processors. We therefore added a separate synchronization op, a separate primitive to deal with I/O synchronization. Given that we had a weekly ordered storage model, the next thing that was required was a way of dealing with locking of storage variables. Like many other people have discovered in this area, the Alpha chip, MIPS 4000, the reservation locking scheme, in fact, gives you good scalability and good granularity. Our implementation of that piggybacks on the cache. Architecturally, we're cleaner than that, but the implementations will, in general, create a reservation on a cache line. The implementation would then investigate any cache hits that occurred associated with outside the single processor that held the reservation, and if it was a conflict on the reservation, remove the reservation from the current processor. So the programming paradigm is a load and reserve, which brings the reservation onto the cache line, and a store conditional, which, if the reservation is still held, will complete successfully or fail if the reservation is lost. This scheme also, if one does not necessarily keep the requirement that the cache line be kept in the cache while the reservation is held, or saying a different way, allowing the implementation not to fetch the line for update but only for read at reservation time, the load and reserve. If you do that, then the store conditional would acquire the line as exclusive, and you can guarantee in that environment that you will at least make forward progress on one of the processors. Another area that we changed or added to in Power architecture was explicit control by the programmer over caching, write through characteristics in the cache, and whether or not a particular page was kept coherent. We added at the page table level then control bits that dealt with caching, a line is cached or not, write through, or whether it's write in, store in, and whether or not a line is coherent. You will find that in the early implementations of our software on the system, they will not take full advantage of it, but we're looking a little bit to the future on this one. We think that in clusters of machines that deal with non-uniform memory, these bits will play a significant role reducing the traffic associated with the coherency protocol. We also think that even in symmetric multiprocessors that have uniform memory, it is often the case that in special applications like database applications, the explicit control over coherency by the database program is a clear win when the program absolutely knows that it's the only program touching a piece of data. It can deal with pushing the data from the cache to the storage system, making it globally visible with our primitives, and it can mark the data when it's referencing it in a non-coherent fashion. In the cache area, we brought most of the cache instructions forward from Power. We made them mostly non-privileged, and we added one additional type of instruction, a touch instruction. Actually, there are two here. One is touch for reading, another one is touch for writing. This allows programs that deal, like I mentioned before, with very large amounts of data, highly optimized with floating point, to pre-plan their storage accesses. So problems like Blasgen and Blasgen set of problems now can be very cleverly programmed to take advantage of these instructions so that while the processor is busy doing the current instructions and loading the data and performing the floating point operations, these instructions would allow the processor to fetch instructions pre-stage, fetch data, pre-stage data into the cache. Perhaps the most difficult area in aggressive superscalar implementations is prefetching. It takes two forms. The first one is instruction prefetching. This happens naturally. Instructions are brought into the cache. You've prefetched some of the instructions before you actually execute them. More importantly, in order to cover branch delays, oftentimes implementation will take multiple paths based on either a prediction which way the branches will go, or just blindly do both paths of the instruction. The other side of this is speculative execution. Now, you cannot do a speculative store unless you have a way of calling back the data or understanding what the data was before you speculatively stored it. But a load is a slightly different matter. So these two things, speculative execution of loads and instruction prefetching, in a very aggressive implementation really get you in trouble if the I/O is really memory mapped. If the processor doesn't know, and it doesn't, where the I/O is, you will end up in a situation that the processor, based on optimizations it's trying to do, will touch areas that are triggers in the I/O system. We are now preventing that in PowerPC by adding a guarded bit to the page table. This will, when set by software, keep the processor from aggressively prefetching within a cache line. Once it's started, the cache line is fine, and it certainly would stop speculative stores. Mike talked to you about 64-bit addressing. I'm going to talk a little bit about 64-bit computations. We did very simple things, as Mike indicated. We simply grew our GPRs to 64 bits. They were already 32. Going to 64 increased the area in the chip a little bit, but not a lot. The FPRs were already 64 bits. We had no change. The special registers in general were 32. We decided in almost all cases to leave them at 32. The exceptions were the ones in the branch unit that contained addresses. They had to go to 64 bits. The link register and the count register are the two registers that we defined. All the instructions, as Mike pointed out, work in 64 bits, although what a program might expect to get from the instruction is interpreted by the mode bit. So carry is covered by the mode bit, and so you get the right answer. The program, however, can still use the 64 bits if it cares to. That would prevent portability of that 32-bit program to a 32-bit implementation, but it's there. And at some point in time, I think that the machines will be built at 64-bit implementations only, and it'll become less of an issue. The other thing we had to add were instructions that dealt with shifts. Like everybody else who's faced this going from 32 to 64 bits, none of us guessed that when we did our first architecture, we had to have the shift amount being a 6-bit field to cover 64 bits. Every one of us have had to add in instructions to allow a 64-bit. So we have both a 32-bit set and a 64-bit set. We added instructions to load and store double word, and we also added instructions to load and extend sign. The situation here was very similar to what we have with load half and extend sign. Now the half is a word, a full 32 bits, and we have to extend it to a full 64 bits. And our friend long divide came back. Now we really did have 64-bit registers, and we could generate results based on 64 bits of division, but not 128. In summary, then, I'd like to say some things that we've are able to accomplish with our changes to PowerPC architecture. We maintained, first and foremost, compatibility with Power. That compatibility is at the binary level. All programs will run. There are a class of programs that recompilation will be necessary if the performance is unsatisfactory. It's a very, very small set of the programs that actually use the instructions we deleted heavily. And so our view is that there is really very limited impact of these changes in moving to PowerPC architecture. We simplified the architecture. We removed the inhibitors that were in the architecture for aggressive superscalar designs. We removed critical path items. We think then that this architecture will allow us to build low-end, single chip, very cheap processors. It will allow us to build the most aggressive superscalars that anyone so far has tackled, and all the places in between. We define symmetric multiprocessing in a style that allows for scalability, keeping with our principles of weakly ordered storage model, and now we've added 64 bits. Just a moment I'd like to say, talking about Somerset, that's the name of the joint IBM Motorola activity and the chips that they are building. We recently announced the 601 chip. It is a 66 megahertz chip. I think conservatively that the integer spec marks will be 50 and in spec 92, and that the, again, very conservatively, that the floating spec marks will be around 80. Again, that is for the chip. We have to consider the issues of how the chip is packaged and put into a system and what the storage interfaces are. And again, I think those numbers are conservative. Somerset is also building three other chips, 603, which is a very low-end, meant for laptop, a single chip implementation, a 604, which is a natural outgrowth of the 601. We think that 604 will propagate with up and down the RS6000 line, replacing most of our RS6000s in the certainly in the mid-range today. And lastly, we're doing a very, very aggressive 64-bit superscalar implementation called the 620. I look forward to seeing these chips in 603, 4, and 20 in sometime next year. And I think it will be the proof of the pudding in these architecture changes that we were able to change the architecture that allowed this very, very wide range of implementations. Thank you and peace.